Last week, we arrived to Mitzvah 210. Just a quick announcement. On next Monday, I won't be here. I'm going to Canada, so I won't be here. But we're going back on schedule on the following Monday. In general, always before you come to a lecture, please check in my website on events. You have over there the schedule, and sometimes due to weather or anything like this, if the lecture gets canceled, then we put a note that you don't waste your time. In 16 years, I can count on one hand how many lectures got canceled, maybe two in 16 years from thousands, so it's very rare. But still, sometimes there's a change in a plan or change of location, so it's always good to check. So I repeat, next Monday, I won't be here, but we're coming back on the following Monday. Okay, so the last mitzvah that we did, we were going about all the forbidden relationship in the Torah, all of them. And actually, we review the parasha, Acharei Mot. There is a lot of forbidden relations over there in the Torah. We read it on Yom Kippur, and I mean, it's an important time. And there's a list of all the Gilui Arayot, and to make sins with animals. That was the last mitzvah that we spoke about. Now we are going to continue 211. We are still in the same category. In general, before the Torah was forbidden the people to make all kinds of despicable act, anything which is against the way God made nature is automatically a sin. But some are much worse than the other. So, in general, the last mitzvah, number 210, it was not to make any kind of... The person should not have a relation with his animals, like Bilam had, with his donkey. That's a big sin from the Torah. Even for a goy, it doesn't matter. Even a Jew, a goy, or needless to say, a Jew, is forbidden. Also, here now, mitzvah number 211, a specific sin for the women. Before it was a general sin, now it's specific sin for the women not to do what we just mentioned. So that was number 211. Mitzvah number 212, mitzvah to fear. When I say fear, I don't mean fear that they hit you, but fear which is involved with lots of respect to your parents. A person has an obligation to have fear from his parents, just like he fears Hashem, he has to fear his father and his mother. And this is the way the Torah says, Ish imo ve'aviv tirau. A person should fear his mother and father. In another place, the Torah says, to respect your father and mother. The order is changed. Over here, when it comes to fear, it says first the mother and then the father, because usually people fear automatically their father, but not so much the mother. So the Torah told you the mother is just as important. It starts with the mother. When it comes to respect, the Torah says, usually a person respects automatically his mother. So the Torah says, over there, kabed et avicha ve et imecha. Your father comes first. So basically what people are normally weak at, it comes first in a verse in the Torah. So it's two different mitzvot. One is to respect them and one is to fear them. What does it mean to fear? Let me give you examples. Of course, we can give a whole very long lecture about it. But I would like first to, just give an example. First, not to sit in the place. Your father, your mother, they sit over there. You don't sit there. And then when they talk, you don't interfere with what they say. You don't break into, or you don't say to them, no, it's not true. It wasn't like this. Or you're wrong. You have to learn again. You know, a person doesn't talk to him like he speaks to his friends. He obviously has to give a lot of respect, but also, like I say, it's fear. Lo soter et dvarav, which means it doesn't contradict him. If he teaches to others the wrong halacha, then he can say it in a nice way. Didn't you teach me once, Father, that this is the way it is? Which means, even when he said that, because now it's critical, maybe people will learn the wrong thing, he has to do it with lots of respect. Even if the father or the mother beat him, hit him, and spit in his face in front of all the important people. Let's try to imagine a scenario. He is the president of a very important company and all the executive seats in a convention, whatever, and his father or his mother comes in, break in front of everyone, in front of the camera, in front of everything, and they start beating him up and spit in his face, right? He is not allowed to make a beep, nothing. What happened if they ripped his suit? Let's say he has an expensive suit, they ripped it off. So later, quietly, they can demand to pay for the damage, for the financial damage. But they're not allowed to make a beep about, even if they became crazy, which is very, very common in our days, that many parents unfortunately become crazy, either the father or the mother, all kinds of mental issues, and take medication or depression or anything like this. Like I said, many people have this problem in this generation, even if they become crazy and they don't control what they say. And obviously, what's the point of respecting someone who is not aware of what he's doing, what he's saying? Yeah, but you still have to give them respect in front of the people in general, because not everyone understands that they're crazy. You gotta be very careful. Yeah, but if they became completely crazy, you know, like, there's no, you cannot even communicate with them one sentence, and they don't dress, or they get dirty, or they don't take a shower for a year, or they're saying all kinds of dirty things, it's already an embarrassment for you. You don't have an obligation to stay and take care of them. You can run away. You can go to the United States. You can go to Israel. Run away. Of course, why? Because it's impossible for you to handle the situation with them because they're not normal. They need professional help. And you are not the one who would be able to do it. So, Yachol le'anicham can leave them alone and go. Doesn't have to go that far. He can go to a different city, right? But this is it. But when he leaves, he has to make sure to leave someone to take care of them, like a maid, a nurse, or put them in an institution that they have professional help. You understand? Even a mamzer, that is an illegitimate boy, which is a woman who cheated on her husband and became pregnant from a stranger, and now, he's thinking, how can I respect my father? He's such a despicable human being who went with a married woman of another man. How can I give respect to such a dirty person? The answer is, he's not allowed to be harsh to him or to attack him or to do anything like that. You understand? So we are seeing here something very interesting. Now you have to know one thing. I know what I'm saying is a little bit sensitive, but there's an argument between top authorities in halacha if a person is obligated to respect his parents when they're wicked to Hashem, when they don't observe the Sabbath, they disrespect Hashem, they steal, they cheat, they do all kinds of bad things, and they are not respecting Hashem, and they're also telling him to do all kinds of things. If they tell him to do something against the Torah or against Chazal, then everyone agrees, doesn't have to listen to them. Not allowed to listen to them. But now we are not talking that they're forcing him to become secular or to violate the laws of the Torah. This, nobody gives permission. We are now talking that the father said to him, go get me this, go do this for me, cook for me, go get me that, go get me this. And this father is a Rasha, according to the Torah, is a wicked person. It's a question if he has to give him respect or not. Le'alacha, we do respect, and we order the people to give respect to their parents because it's always better in a nice way than in a war. Usually you don't achieve anything in war. So everyone who asks this question, the answer is yes, you gotta give them respect. But we have to know a few things. What happens if your father tell you, go get me cigarettes? Go get me cigarettes. Cigarettes kill. It's no question. Everybody knows it kills. It takes few minutes of the life of a person every cigarette. That's what the specialists claim. So obviously, if a person smoked 20, 40 cigarettes every day, 10, 20, 30 years, he shortened his life substantially. But the question is, if you don't go and buy him cigarettes, he gets very angry. And then he has an argument. If you get him a cigarette, you're helping him to die with your own end. Or what happens if you're a doctor If a person cut his father and made him bleed, or his parents in general, then it's chayav mita, is a very big serious problem. But what happens if he's a doctor and he wants to operate like a dentist? He gives a shot to his father and he bleeds. He makes him bleed, or his mother, or he has to cut surgery on their body, as now they have to take their clothes off, it's no respect. There's a lot of questions when it comes to it. In general, a person is not allowed to take any blood out of his parents. Nothing. Even if they give him permission, some say still not allowed. So it's always better to direct him to another specialist, your friend, your colleague, somebody in your office. Let him do it and get out of the doubt. If there's nobody as good as you, so to help them and to cure them, after all, it's allowed. But if there is somebody else to do it, it's better they'll do it. Also, I give you another example. What happened if a woman wants to go to a gynecologist? Is she allowed to go to a man or no? That's a question now. You have this kind of guy in the neighborhood, in the area, he's a doctor over there, and she's going to go to him. It's not modest. There's all kinds of issues here. So the answer is, if there is a female doctor anywhere, even to drive an extra half an hour, that she's just as good as the male in the area, she must go to the female, not to the male. If they live in a place, I don't know, in Zimbabwe, there's no female doctors, only male. And there's nobody, that's it, nobody. Obviously, it can be all kinds of infection, problems, it's maintaining the health. Then in general, it's permitted because the doctor, this is his art, this is his work. Once he does it every day, the chance that he's going to be sinning is much, much smaller, even though there's always an exception to the rule, and sometimes you hear about things like this. So a kosher woman has to try to do everything she can, never to see a male doctor. Everything she can, even driving an extra hour, even waiting an extra month. Usually that's the case. Oh, you want to see the female? The next appointment is in 2 months. No, so 2 months, if I have to suffer another month waiting, I'm not talking life risk. Life risk, right away, amen, no question. I'm talking inconvenience. You know, it's not so comfortable, whatever. Then female comes first. Now, going back to our subject, so a person has to be extremely careful with the way he speaks to his parents. In our generation, the kids become 13, and many of them are not mature, and they talk very bad to their parents, and they're going to be punished for it. Even though Hashem knows that the 13 years old of today, it's like 3 years old of 2,000 years ago, like 3 years old in a mental state. But bar mitzvah is bar mitzvah. The law never changed. Bar mitzvah, you're a man already. You know, you're responsible for what you do. So it's very, very problematic situation today. The kids, they are not capable of understanding every word that they speak to their parents, what punishment they are subject to. Plus, when the boy becomes bar mitzvah, father should never hit him. Why? He may return, throw something at him from anger, push him, beat him up, all kinds of things. The older he gets, the more dangerous he gets. It's a problematic issue. To raise children today, it's almost impossible. You have to just hope that your son automatically is righteous, came to the world righteous and doesn't give you a hard time. If he's not righteous and he's attracted to negative things, you got to take the suffering, and there's not that much you can do besides crying to Hashem around the clock. I always tell people, some people are very frustrated when they're single. I have a fantastic way to cheer them up. Tell them, do you want to stand by me 2-3 hours of my schedule to hear the married people, how much they suffer? Come stand 2-3 hours. You see what's going on. Hear some messages. Believe me. You're going to say, Hashem, shtabach shemo. You know? What do you think? It's easy? People, kids, they're cute, baby. Mazal tov. This baby can be Esav in 20 years. Every week you get a phone call from the police, come get your son, he's arrested here, arrested there. I was once in L.A., a father was coming to tell me, you see this son of mine, I'm begging you, maybe you talk to him, maybe you save him. I look at this boy, Hashem Yirachem, not boy, he's an older kid. Oh, he's a So he said to me, I'm calling the police to tell on him. Because the only way I have 2 or 3 weeks to leave is when he's in jail. Just he comes out of jail, my nightmare begins. So I do everything I can to lock him in. I see him touching drugs, right away I call the police. I already have their number, their personal number. They come and arrest him. You understand the generation we live in? That the father wants to go to sleep and to be able that his son won't come and choke him in the middle of the night or steal his car or money, he has to make sure that he gets arrested. There's a lot of problems in this generation. But the idea is that the halacha never changed. Person has to be very careful, he has to have to be grateful to his parents, never dare to talk to them, never dare to insult them, never dare to imitate them, to make fun at them. You know, when you hear someone speaking against them, even if he's right, he has to protest. This is your father, it's not a stranger from the street. There's many, many laws apply to it. This was mitzvah number 212. Number 213, not to even dare to think about idol worshiping. Most of the sins in the Torah, if you did it or not, you thought I'm going to be Mechalel Shabbos now. This is a great deal. I can make $1 million. Hashem, only 5 minutes I'll be Mechalel Shabbos and then I'll do tshuva. And then you regret. Didn't count you were Mechalel Shabbos. You stopped yourself on the time. But if you thought, Hashem, what's the big deal? This guy is offering me $1 million if I bow down to his idol. You know how many Baalei Tshuva I can make with this? What's the big deal? I go down to his nonsense, he gives me $1 million cash, and I'll do so much. Just for the thought, already a person violated the Torah. Worse than eating pork. Just the thought. Forget about that in the end he did not do it. So when it comes to idol worshiping, just it crosses your mind. If it comes, obviously, the evil inclination always push bad things to the person's mind. First, second is never a sin. First look at the not modest woman in the street is not a sin. First look. Came out of the bank. Oh. Second sin, it begins to count. Why? The second is that when a person already continue, now he's choosing. First one was an accident. Second, third, fourth. That's already a clear sin from the Torah. He's looking at something he's not allowed. Same thing over here. If all of a sudden an image of Buddha came to him, because they took him from his stupid school to see a show, and they get him into this place of Buddhism, and he has to see all these idols. And the next day when he comes to pray, it comes to his mind. First, second, it's nothing. He has to do anything he can to get rid of this thought. Also, when he passed through a church, better not to look at this place. One woman from Texas sent an email yesterday that she went on a tour somewhere and they wanted her to go into the churches. Almost the whole tour is going from one church to another to see their artwork. You understand? So she said, well, how about taking me to some synagogue in this area? It wasn't here, it was in Europe somewhere. So they got very angry. First, that she doesn't agree to come into the church. And second is that she dared to ask if there's any synagogue in the area that she can also see. You understand? So this is it. So Machshava, even the Machshava, needless to say, when he talks about this idol, you know, I saw these Chinese people where they go around this idol and they dance and all these things, it's already a sin. Talking about it, looking at it, it's all a sin. Most people don't know it. They think, well, I'm never going to dare to worship this stupid idol. Of course not. Why? But to think about it and to talk about it, it's also a problem. Right? Why is it? Why Hashem is so strict that you can't even think about it? You can't even look at it? You can't even talk about it? Why? Because maybe it will attract you to follow their nonsense. You know how it is. Come on Sunday. The father is giving a speech. Come, we'll help you with the rent. Don't worry. You have no plan to follow their nonsense. You say, you know, maybe I can get a few $1,000 out of him to pay my mortgage. Once you get there, one thing leads to another. 2 years later, you see this guy became a priest. Why? Hashem Yirachem. It's not permitted. Okay, now, mitzvah number 214. Not to make, not to create any idol, anything of Avodah Zarah. not to create. They ask you, make us a statue of Buddha. You're an artist. And we'll buy it from you. Not allowed to make. Not for yourself and not for anyone else. Why? You give it to this goy, you're helping him to violate a basic rule against God. Making an idol for the goyim is not permitted. What happens if you own a store in Manhattan and you sell crosses, 47th Street over there in a gold? There's all kinds of crosses, gold, all kinds of things of Avodah Zarah. So if it's just a cross, you're allowed to sell it to them. Why? The cross itself is not an idol. It's a symbol. It's like we have Star David, they have this. Once there is already an image of JC hanging over there, like this, waiting for someone to take him off, then it's already a problem. Now it's an idol. Now it's already an idol because they kiss it, they bow down to it when they see it. That's already an idol. And needless to say, if it's a big idol, or pictures, all kinds of things of Avodah Zarah, not allowed. Then, mitzvah number 215. Not to eat from the leftover of the sacrifices that it's called Kodashim. When they sacrifice it, once every sacrifice has a limit, up to here you can eat it. Then from there, you have to burn the rest. From now on, you're not allowed to eat from it. So the Torah say, Lo ya'achel ki kodeshem, and then he says, Kol sheba kodesh pasul, liten lo ta'aseh al achilato, which means this is now a restriction. It's a lo ta'aseh, it's a violation. Sometimes the Torah say, in a positive language, sometimes in a restriction. Sometimes the same transaction appears in a Taryag Mitzvot, it's two different scenes. One time it comes in the Torah in a positive way, like for instance, clean the chametz out of your home. And then it comes, do not have chametz in your home. Why do you need both? It's the same thing. One cover the other, no? Make sure you don't have chametz in your home. Don't keep chametz. It's a restriction. Clean the house from chametz. That's an obligation. Why Hashem needs to? First of all, it doubles the punishment. Second, there are different rules apply when it's a restriction or when it's a positive commandment to do. For instance, restriction is worse. It's worse. It's also more difficult to make tshuva on it. A person has to sacrifice more not to violate a restriction than a positive commandment. You understand? So there's different things apply. And of course, it's very deep. But in general, over here, now we are talking a restriction. Now, mitzvah number 216, it's called mitzvat pe'ah. We have leket, shichecha, pe'ah. It's usually today apply only to farmers in Eretz Israel, but today it's not as is the time of Bet HaMikdash. But let me explain to you. Most of us, we are not farmers. We don't grow wheat, barley. We don't have trees, orchards, vineyards. We don't have all these things. So many of the laws that applies to these things in the Torah really doesn't touch us in our life, especially if we live in overseas. In America, it's exile. Then we have even less things to do. People who live in Israel, they have a little more. Farmers have much more. But most of the people, because of that, because it doesn't apply to every day, most people don't learn it all their life. It can be 7 years old, Shomer Shabbat 50 years, and doesn't know these things. So that's an opportunity to get a rough idea what is all these things that the Torah talks about. For instance, the Torah say, La'aniach pe'ah min ha'tvua, leave some of the wheat, we'll soon explain how, and leave it to the poor and to the converts. Poor and the converts. Poor, we understand. Poor has nothing to eat. He waits until you finish, stands over there, when everyone goes, he comes and eats. But why to the convert? The answer is a convert is just like a poor person. He's poor physically and he's poor mentally. Why mentally? He lost his parents, he lost his siblings, he lost everyone. He comes to a new world, he doesn't know anyone. People, for whatever reason, I never get to understand that. I mean, if you follow the Torah, you follow. If you don't follow, you don't. I don't understand why sometimes yes, sometimes no. That doesn't make sense. The Torah says 36 times to give extra attention and respect and love and assistance to the converts. Today, it looks like it's exactly the opposite. Most from people, most religious people disrespect the converts, holding them a second-class citizen. That's not what Hashem said. A real kosher convert is in a higher level than all of us. So I don't really know where it comes from. The only kafzchut I can say about it, there were too many fake converts in the recent history that created bad reputation to the community of the gerim, of the converts. And some communities decided, you know what, we had enough with this. And now they are keeping themselves away from them. But the truth is, I just want to give you an example. I was in touch with a girl from Venezuela. She's sending emails, asking questions, watching the lectures. And another guy from Mexico, two South American people, one in Venezuela, one in Mexico, speaking to the girl, answering her question, speaking to the guy, answering them questions. In Mexico, they don't accept converts. So you have to go either to Canada or to Israel or to United States, to places that the court accepting converts. In Mexico, no converts. So what happened now? He asked me what to do. After going back and forth with him, and I saw the level of Yirat Shamayim this person has, very serious goy, learning, doing, keeping mitzvot, amazing, hamash amazing. And also the girl. So I suggested that they'll come and we'll convert him here. We convert them. After so many converts, Baruch Hashem, already you develop relationship with the Beit Din, they trust your judgment to know that the fake one you screen right away, and if finally you recommend one, they take it right away and they do it. Save them a lot of time and aggravation. So anyway, what happened is they came, they started to come to the lectures, they became even more serious, found them a place to live, everything would have found a job, mamash, you see the Siyata Dishmaya of HaKadosh Baruch Hu. And what happened in the end? The girl yesterday officially converted. She already dipped in a mikveh. The guy, Baruch Hashem, had Brit Milah. And you need to wait a little bit until you go into the mikveh after the Brit Milah. So another week or so is going to be officially converting. And the good news is that right after, they're getting married. So it's a whole package deal. You got everything. You got the airfare, you got the car, you got the hotel, you got everything. You know, it's beautiful. Now, the Torah say one of the reasons HaKadosh Baruch Hu spread the Jews all over the world, besides the punishment of the sins, is to teach the converts how to convert and how to be Jews. To go all over the world and to be the light for the goyim. Unfortunately, sometimes the Jews forgot their job. They became like the goyim. You know, it's like a person come to collect your debt. This guy comes to you. You owe my boss $10,000. Where is the money? The next day, the boss find out that he sits and play backgammon with you. They became friends. There's cases like this in the Gemara. The Romans, they were sending Unculus. He was the nephew of Titus. After he became a Jew, started to learn serious and this, they used to send him all the time Romans to convince him to come back. Hey, you're not just an ordinary goy. You're from the royal family. Every group the king was sending, he converted, convinced them. Made them a seminar, gave them Torah and science, showed them the debate. They said, okay, let's not waste time. They stayed. The third group he sent, he told them, make sure you don't talk anything. Don't talk. He start talking up, nothing. I don't want to hear. Block your ears, bring him over. Nothing helped them. In the end, they gave up. And he became one of the most famous chachamim in history. In every chumash in the world, you see his words. It's not a joke here. So one of the things is you got to leave it for the converts. Why? The guy just converted a week ago. He doesn't have the language. He doesn't have a job. He doesn't know anything. What is he going to do? Leave him. Let him come and take and eat. Save him the embarrassment. He cannot go to his biological parents. They're very upset that he left the church. So at least leave him something to eat. Hashem thought about everything. So, also, Sometimes the Torah talks about the converts, the orphans, and the widows. Also people that have difficult time. So for instance, when it comes to Maaser Ani, you know, the Torah says, Lager ve'layatom ve'la'almana, you leave it. Understand? So what is it, Peah? When a person cut his wheat, he leaves in the corner of his field. He will leave a bunch over there. The Torah didn't tell you how much. Really, from Hashem's, it's up to your generosity. If you're afraid to go to the bathroom that you have to eat again, you're so stingy, so you leave few. But if you're a generous guy, leave a lot. Why do you worry? It's only wheat. It's not diamonds here. But the Chachamim said, make sure it's at least 1 out of 60, which is 1.6%. You understand? So for every 1,000 wheat, 16 you leave. You do the calculation, that's what it is. So mitzvah number 217, shelo lechalot ha-pea basadeh. Here is another perfect example. Just before I say, leave some of the wheat, pea, in a corner of your field for the poor and for the converts. Now the Torah says, don't finish cutting your entire field to the end. Leave some. It's the same thing. Obligation to do, restriction not to do. Same thing. Over here. Shelo liktzor et kol hazaruah. Ya'azov mimeno she'erit la'aniim. Not to cut everything. Leave some for the poor in the edge of the field, in the corner. She'ne'emar lo techale pe'at satcha be'kutzercha. When you cut it, don't destroy everything. Just leave some over there. Mitzvah number 218, it's mitzvah that called leket. What is it, leket? Leket, you have to leave for the poor people. What is it, leket? It's what's falling. They used to have a tool, it's called magal. Magal, why it's called magal? Come from the word agol. What's agol? Agol means round. They have a handle, and from the handle you have like a shape of a moon, like a half a circle. And where did they go? They didn't have tractors like today. You know, you sit in a tractor with air condition and cut the weeds. They didn't have, so they had to go like this all day, working in the hot weather. They go like this, and it's very sharp. And it cuts the weeds from the bottom, and they cut them, they put bundles later, and that's how it used to be. But since it's round, it gathers a bunch. There's always few falling, here one, here two. So some of it are falling. So some of the ones who falls, you leave. But how much? There's rules. If 20 fell out of 50, then you don't leave. You pick them up. How much you have to leave? The Torah says like this. Shibolet achat o shnaim, one or two, it's called leket. Three and more, it's not leket. Which means every shot that you hit, if you had up to two, one or two fail, that means Hashem wants it for the poor people. Leave it, don't touch it. It's not yours anymore. But three and up, that's already a substantial percentage. No, pick it up. You understand? So this is the rule of leket. What? Mitzvah number 219. Before we said, leave it, what fell, leave it for the poor people. Now, exactly the same, but in the opposite language, restriction. Don't pick up what fell. The Torah say, leave it for the poor, that's obligation. Don't pick up what fell, same thing. Doubling right away, it's two out of 613. It was one transaction. Two different commandments from the 613. Mitzvah number 220. It's called Mitzvat Anachat Pe'at HaKerem. Pe'at HaKerem, what's Kerem means? Kerem. Vineyards. When you have all the grapes on the way to upstate, you see they have many of them. They have the cows, and right next to them you see a lot of a lot of, sometimes in Brooklyn also people grow some grapes, you know, but that's not a commercial amounts. One or two bushes, it's nothing. But what does it mean? What do you have to do right now? There are bunches over there that you have to also leave for the poor, for the convert, you have to leave them. Why? The Torah says, Karmicha lo te'olel. Rambam says that this is olelot shebakerem. What? Instead of leaving pe'ah, like in the fields. So over here, we leave some of the grapes who falls over there for the poor and the converts. We have to leave them. There's many laws apply to it. We don't have time, obviously, to cover everything. But the general, just to get the idea, same thing you have with the wheat, you have now with the grapes. And mitzvah number 221, not to destroy pe'at ha-kerem. Same concept. Before it was to leave, now not to pick up. Lo lechalot, not to finish. Not to finish. Some of them, pe'ah, you leave for the poor people. Right? That's called pe'at ha-kerem. Then, mitzvah number 222, it's mitzvat anachat peret akerem, to leave peret akerem to the poor people. You know, what does it mean? You see, so over here, sometimes the grapes fall when they bunch, like before what I meant, when they fall olelot, bunches, sometimes singles falling. So now the Torah says like this, מה שיתפרד ויפול מן הענבים בשעת פצירה. You know, יפרד means singles falling, singles coming out of the group. Right? לעני ולגר תעזוב אותם. You leave them for the poor and for the converts, גר צדק. Right? מצווה number 223, same thing. Before it say leave it, now it say don't pick it up. Same idea. That's to leave the grapes for the poor and for the converts. Mitzvah number 224, not to steal, not to be a thief. Yesterday I gave a 2 hours lecture right here in Beit Gavriel about gezel, 4 different kinds of stealing in the Torah. What is it? One is lo tignov, should not steal. One is lo tigzol. What's the difference? We'll soon understand. One is chamas, to be chomes. And one is, it's called when oshek. Le'man nechdal me'oshek yadenu. We have to stop with our oshek, with our this form of stealing. What's the difference between 4? Stealing means behind your back. You hang your pants in a locker room. Somebody looks around. Oh, he steals something from the pocket and runs. That's called stealing, gonev, gneva. Gezel, in your face. Come to your store. What's this? Take it and run out. In your face. Not embarrassed from you. He runs, but he doesn't want to get caught. But in your face. Doesn't wait until you go to the back and steal. In your face. Grab it and run. What's chamas? Chomes. Chomes means a person like your tie. You're fixing your tie, you're about to put it on your neck, and you say, let me see. Wow, beautiful tie. It takes $20, you throw it on the counter, and take it. Hey, it's not for sale. Shh, I didn't ask you. Here is your money. You understand? Sounds like what's happening with the protection, you know, in a business. We came to help you, sir. Help me? I don't remember asking for help. We didn't ask if you need help or not. We know you need help. Here is the business card of Don Corleone. When you have a problem, you call us. Somebody gives you a hard time, we protect you. But we want $10,000 a month. We look at the business, $10,000 cash. We come on the first of every month, prepare a bag with $10,000 cash. What happens if you call the police? You're dead. So obviously it's not an option. Then what? What happens if 1 month you didn't pay? They come to collect and you don't pay. The next day, your car is burning. Then they come again, you don't pay. They catch you somewhere, break with the hammer, they break your knees. You become handicapped now. Third time, you're dead, or your whole family is dead, or your kids disappeared. They cannot win against them. It's organized crime. That's called protection. It's here, it's in New York, it's in Israel, it's everywhere. It's everywhere. People are paying. There's nothing you can do. So that's called Chomes. Come, we want to buy your business. No, the business is not for sale. No, we like it. How much? 100,000. No, here, take 10,000, get out of here by tomorrow. You have no choice. You're going to sell the business. That's called Chomes. With force. What is it, Oshek? Oshek, lo ta'ashok. What does it mean, Oshek? That when you got the money, you got it, it was yours. It's with permission. Now when the time comes to give it to a person who deserves it, you don't release it. You're holding the money to yourself. What does it mean? You have a worker. He works for you all week. Up to now, you had permission to keep the money. The due date didn't arrive. Let's say you're paying him every Friday. You agree. So Thursday night, it's still your money. You can do whatever you want with that as long as you have it for tomorrow. Right now, it's in my pocket. I'm not a thief. Tomorrow, I got to pay you a salary. The due date didn't arrive. As long as the due date didn't arrive, I'm not violating any rules, even a minute before. But when the time comes and I don't pay and he asks for the money, I have no permission to keep it unless if he gives me a clear permission to keep it another day or two. Or it's an accident. It happens one time that the boss had a bad week and he cannot pay on time, but it's all with permission of the worker. If not, he has a serious problem. Serious problem. So what's going on here? He doesn't pay his worker the commission. He agreed with him on the 5% commission besides the salary, and he cheat him. Cheat him, he doesn't give him. Or he say, oh, the commission is not so urgent. I'm paying you every week. Commission I'll give you once every 3 months. No, but that's not wasn't the deal. Listen, business is not so great now. Wait for your commission. Then a year or two, and it's growing and growing. And in the end, of course, he doesn't give anything. That's called Oshek.
Of the four categories, which is the worst?
All of them are equally bad, but the gazlan, the Gemara asks, which one is worse, a thief or a gazlan? Which is, the difference is if you do it in the face of the person or behind his back. And the Torah says someone who does it behind his back is worse. Why? You may think it should be the other way around. You know, at least he's embarrassed for what he's doing, so he's hiding and stealing. What's better to come in your face and steal from your pocket? But the answer is, because the gazlan doesn't care about you, he steals in your face, and doesn't care about Hashem. So you and Hashem is equal. He doesn't care about you, he doesn't care about Hashem, he doesn't care about anyone. The ganav, he cares about you, but he doesn't care about Hashem, which means you are more important in his eyes than Hashem. Because from you, he's afraid. But from Hashem, he's not afraid. Different point of view to look at things. We may think, oh, look at the thief. At least he's hiding when he steals. Doesn't steal in loud and clear. Yeah, but this is it. Also, you should also know, as far as punishment, the thief has the worst punishment. Why? Because if he gets caught, he has to pay double. For instance, if he stole a cow worth $3,000, now he got caught, he has to pay 2 cows or 6,000. What happened if he make steaks from the cow? He slaughtered it, made steaks, sold it. Now when they come, where is the cow? You ate it on Shabbos, Rabbi. What do you mean? I made good steaks from it in my butcher shop. Now he has to pay 4 times or 5 times, depend. Four or five times. So what's going on here? We see that the thief having something that called knas. But there is a rule that if the thief admitted before he got caught, modeh al pi atzmo, it means he comes and say, I stole the cow the other day and now came to make tshuva now. Even if tomorrow we would catch him, the police is very close to find the thief, but he came to confess, all he has to do is to pay what he stole, nothing extra. Why? Once he admitted, there's no penalty, right? Many times we see in the Torah that the Torah urge the sinners to make tshuva, repentance, by giving them incentives. And where the Torah did not give enough incentive for the sinner to make tshuva, came Chazal, the rabbis, and gave those incentive. Thanks to that, we get saved. Because, for instance, in the time of the... If a person come and steal one screw, he come to your house, he saw a screw in a toolbox, and he took it. How much a screw cost? 5 cents, 10 cents, whatever. Then he built the Empire State Building, and your screw is on the 37th floor in a living room of Donald Trump. One of the walls, your screw is right there. Then you come to him and say, I want my screw back. I know you stole it, I saw. He say, yeah, it's true. Let me go get you from Home Depot a screw. No, my friend, I want that screw. What do you mean? I'll get you a different screw, the same thing. No, my friend, I don't want replacement. I want that one. I want that stick. I want that table. I want that rug. I don't want replacement. I want the same one that you took. But it's inside the building. Your problem, not mine. From the Torah, you had to knock down the Empire State Building and give him the screw. Baruch Hashem, Hashem gave power to the Chachamim to make rules. Chachamim knew if that's what you're going to tell the thieves, nobody will return anything. I know how greedy people are. And they made a takana, a decree that called takanat hashavim. The decree, the law of the repenting people, which means you come and get a different screw, throw it in his face and say, here is your screw, goodbye. He screamed, no, I'm not touching, I'm not taking it. I don't want it, I want that one. Your problem, not mine. Still has to get mechila. It's different things now. Offending him and this. But for the stealing, you come to Shamayim, you're not a thief. You have a problem, ben adam lechaverot, that your friend is angry for what you did, whatever. But stealing, I don't owe anyone anything. I paid back. That's called takanat hashavim. Now, we're talking now about stealing. It's mitzvah number 224. Not to steal any kind of money, any kind of property, any kinds of anything that has a value. Now, many people make a common mistake. They think that you should not steal is in the Ten Commandments. That's not true. The you should not steal in the Ten Commandments is talking about kidnapping people. Much worse sin. That's a matter of life and death now already. But you should not steal money. It's in Vayikra Yutet, Leviticus 19. That's where it's over there. It's in few places in the Torah. One of them is Leviticus 19, verse 11. The Torah says, Lo tegnovu. And Chazal explained, this is a warning for a person who steals valuable things. Right? And where does it appear also? It appears in Parashat Mishpatim in the Torah, when there's many, many laws in that chapter. It's appear over there. Anything that worth more than pruta, the smallest coin, I think today it's about a quarter or 20 cents. There's a pruta as a value. Everything that worth more than pruta, it's considered money. You can marry a woman with that. You come to your friend, girlfriend, Rachel, I want to marry you, but I have a quarter. Would you take it? She say yes, she's married. You give her a penny, she's not married. So somebody would hear that and say, come on, Rabbi, what is this nonsense? A quarter is an insult, and a penny is an insult. You come, you offer her a quarter, doesn't matter. Up to here, it's considered money. From here, why? When a quarter falls from your pocket, you bend down and pick it up. 99% of the people are still doing it. When a penny falls, nobody picks it up. Ah, penny, where is it? I'm going to start look for it. No, it doesn't worth my time. It doesn't have a value. What happened if a person stole half a coin, which is not a violation from the Torah yet? It's not allowed from the Torah either way, even less than this. But as far as obligation to return, less than kepruta, you don't have an obligation to return. To steal less than that is also stealing, but there's no obligation to return. So what happens if every day you come and steal less than the minimum, half of the minimum, tomorrow half, tomorrow half, tomorrow half? Over the years, you bought a house. This is what Sodom and Gomorrah, Dora Mabul, They used to do it. They used to steal less than Shve Pruta constantly, all the time. Every few hours, they steal a little less. And they say, nobody care. For instance, they come to your fence. You have a fence around your house. And somebody wants to clean his teeth. So he needs a toothpick. But he doesn't have. So what does he do? He come to your massive, big wood fence and chip a little piece. It's anyway half chipped. He chipped a little piece and clean his teeth. And the owner is screaming, he has a $20 million house. You thief! I say, well, it doesn't worth a penny, b'chlal. What's this? He says to him, yeah. But imagine if 1,000 people that passed here every day, each one of them will take only one little toothpick. What's going to happen with my fence? You got the point? So the question is it joined together to become a massive violation, which means you have to be reincarnated again to return it after you died? Or, bottom line, will it prevent you from entering heaven or not? Why? The rule is, if you owe something to anyone, no matter how righteous you are, you cannot go to heaven. You have to come back in reincarnation, and Hashem directs you in life to give it back to the people you owe. So if you only took less than a quarter in our days, 5 cents, 5 cents, nobody cares. But what happens if the owner finds out that you took it 500 times from him? Every day 5 cents from his register. Is now considered that you stole $20? No, or each transaction was dismissed. It's big arguments between the Chachamim. It's not so simple. Some say no, it's not joining together. Still need to make tshuva and ask Hashem to forgive you, because a person should never take anything that is not his, no matter what. But do I have an obligation to look for that guy and return it to him and calculate more or less how much I took? No. Some say yes. Why? Because all the stealing matters is determined based on the common sense of the society, which means if people are makpid, if people are strict about it, you have a problem. If nobody cares about it, you normally don't have a problem. For instance, if you have those pens that you buy $24, you know these plastic pens? If somebody gave it to you and you forgot and you left with that, is he now going to look for you and call you, hey, give me back the pen? The phone call costs more. Nobody cares about this. If he fell from his car, he's going to park the car and look for it now? No. Nobody is makpid. So if you forgot and you took it, you don't have to search for him to return it. What? Mistama umachal. You understand? If you go to a building of someone and you want to go upstairs and you need light, you turn the light on, but he didn't ask permission to use the light. It's costing him now 3 cents from the time you start climbing on the stairs until you enter the house. You made him lose 3 cents. But do you know any normal person who care about this? Nobody cares about it, but you didn't ask permission, but it's not a sin. Things that is obvious that nobody cares is not stealing. Things that is obvious that people care, it's always stealing. Some things, they have an argument if people care or not. Depends. It depends also in what country. Depends on the mentality of the people. So this is the rule. So some rabbi says, no, if a person stole a little by little, when the person finds out that it was a constant transaction, he doesn't look at that as 5 cents, 5 cents, 5 cents. He said, this guy stole from me $20. Now he care. That's why you have to put everything together and return it. One way or the other, whenever there's an argument about a subject that is not clear, what's the law? When it's a sin from the Torah, you have to go to the strict side. You don't take chances. When it's a sin from the Rabbanan, from the sages, you have to go to the lenient side. You can go to the strict side. It's better. But if you went to the lenient side, you have what to count on. Mitzvah number 225. Not to lie about something that we have position on. Which means your friend gave you something to watch for him. You a keeper. Please watch this cow for me until I come back from Israel. Please watch this watch for me. Please, here is my key. Keep it by you until next week when I come back. And then when the person come back and say, where is my thing? He say, I don't know what you're talking about. Never gave me anything. You're wrong. Or I gave it back to you already. All kinds of tricks like this. He has position on it. and he lies and say, I don't have it. The Torah says, Lo tekachashu, do not deny that you have it. Right? Which means the Torah is speaking about money. Vekichesh ba venishba al sheker. What happened when a person comes to court and say, I gave my friend Shimon this CD to watch for me for a week, and now I come to him and he denies. And the judge has to ask, do you have witnesses? He said, no, I trusted him. It's only a CD, but I need it now. And he said, okay, since you don't have witnesses, the other one is denying. So what happened? He has to swear that he doesn't have it. Now, to swear in the name of God is a very, very big sin. It's the third commandment. It's in the Ten Commandments. You know, the laws in the Ten Commandments are very heavy laws. So a person wants to get away with $10, $20 and ended up making a horrible sin. So one thing leads to another. You understand? So the Torah says, do not do it. Lo tekachashu. Then, for instance, someone who got caught denying that he owns it, that he has it, I'm sorry. For instance, you say to him, what are you talking about? I gave it back to you. Or you never gave it to me. And then witnesses saw it by you. You say, I don't have it. I gave it back to you. And the next day, two people saw, you have it, you liar. You have it. What happened? They take you back to the court. From that moment on, you cannot be used as a witness in a Jewish court. You're not a reliable person. Cannot rely on your testimony. What happened? Even if you did not swear, you didn't swear in Beit Din yet, and they found it by you, after you say, I don't have it, you didn't get to the court yet to swear. In between, they already caught you. You cannot be a witness anymore. You consider a wicked person. Why am I saying it? You know, it can apply to each one of us. One little thing sometimes. Like, for instance, somebody gave you to watch something and forgot about it, and you also forgot about it. And 2 years later, he calls you up and says, you know, one time I gave you my tennis racket. Is it still by you? Now, as soon as he tells you that, you remember, oh, yeah, I have it. Wow, why didn't I use it? He forgot about it. Look, now he remembers after 2 years, he gave up already. Mityaesh. Probably gave up. You see, it didn't bother him. He probably have another 10. He's a rich guy. So the greed plays a big role here. Sometimes a person says, you know what? I send them anonymously $20 for whatever it's worth, and I keep it. This is all kinds of things that can make a person make a sin. It's serious sins, all these things. So, of course, it's not allowed. Then, mitzvah number 226. Not to swear that you don't have something that you do have. It's related to the previous mitzvah. Before it was not to deny. Now, denying requires a swearing in a court. Now you have to know, when people came to swear in a Jewish court, it wasn't like today, I swear in my mother, I swear in my cousin, I swear in my wife. Many people like to swear in the life of their wives. Shame. The more I swear, the better I'm going to get free without paying $10 million, you know? But all this kind of swearing today, people say whatever they want, and they think nobody is watching. But in the time of the Beit Din, they used to make fire. They used to make a real ceremony and warn the person. You know what it means to swear in the name of God on a false testament. Believe some people, even that they didn't have it, they were so nervous from the event. So you know what? Forget about it. Take the $100. Let me go. They already see what's going on. You see, you know what? Maybe he gave it to me and I'm senile. I don't know. Maybe I'm losing my mind. You know what? Just take it and leave me. This is how scary it was to swear. The Gemara brings a story about two friends. Used to be friends until that court day. That one gave money to his friend and now he came to collect. And the guy denied. So he said to him, okay, let's go. I want to see how you swear in a Beit Din tomorrow. So they come to the Beit Din. The rabbi say, you have it? Say, no, I return it to him. It's in his hand. So they say, okay, hold the Torah and start swearing. After all the warning, the guy has no fear. He come to his friend and say, here, hold my cane. Let me hold the Torah and swear. I swear that I gave him back all the money. As we speak, I have all the money he gave me. It's already in his possession. This guy standing over there, and said, I can't believe this crook. I can't take this nonsense. He took the cane of this guy and banged on the table so hard he broke it. All the gold coins were inside the cane. They spread all over. So even a thief was afraid to swear on a false testimony. So while he was swearing, he made sure that all the money is in his hand, that at least he's swearing on a true testimony. So I swear that right now, as we speak, I already gave him back all the money. It's not a lie. He gets saved. And a minute later, he's still again. And Baruch Hashem. That's called Naval Bereshut HaTorah. How do you say Naval in English? Despicable? What's the right word for it? Some words, you just don't have words in English for it. Means a despicable crook in the service of the Torah. It's like the lawyers today that they know in the Constitution and in the law where you have cracks in the wall. Oh, here it's legal. If you do it this way, oh, you go to jail for 20 years. Let's do it that way, and there's nothing they can do. Understand? So, as one Haredi, one guy came to Israel many years ago, and they called him bring thousands of bottles of whiskey, smuggling, in the border. So the immigration people and the custom people, they made a party. Wow. In those days, it was very rare to find a religious guy stealing or smuggling. So for them, it was, what a party they're going to make. They bring him to court. They see this Haredi, this religious guy, is not afraid. Sitting there in a court, relaxed, smiling. Say, are we going to destroy this guy and he's not worried? When the judge asks him, what do you have to say for your protection? He says, Your Honor, I never violated the rules of the state of Israel ever. He said, the judge says, is this a joke or what? You got caught with 20,000 bottles of whiskey. You know what penalty you subject to? He told him, I never smuggled. I didn't violate the rules. So how do you explain this? He said, the rule, the book of the law in Israel, saying like this, a person shall not smuggle anything to the territory of Israel without declaring on it, should never smuggle anything through the land or through the water. I smuggled from the air. I came with a plane. Apparently, when they wrote the laws, there was no airplanes. So they wrote only from the land and from the ocean. And he smuggled from the air, and the judge said the case is dismissed. That's called Naval Bereshut HaTorah. Kosher, but smelly. You know, that's what it is. Now, mitzvah number 227, not to swear on any lie. Not only that you have something that you're not supposed to hold. You have to return or something like this. To swear about any kind of lie. There are four categories in this mitzvah. Two about the future and two about the past. Swearing about something already took place is two kinds of scenarios. And two for the future, that this will never happen. So two for the past, two for the future. And now we are entering a little, I'll give you an example. For instance, it says like this. I swear that I ate. Oh, I swear that I did not eat. I swear that I threw. I swear that I did not throw a stone to the pool, whatever. Someone is holding something against him and he's swearing that he never did or he did. Then he has two ways to do it. I swear that I will never throw, and I swear that I will throw. So it's like a neder, like a vow. You understand? Swearing. Swearing and not keeping your swears, it's a sin from the Torah. That's why we start Rosh Chodesh Elul, we do Atarat Shavuot. How do you say Atarat in English? Canceling, dismissing, untying, hard words in the law.
Nullifying.
Huh? Nullifying? Oh, great. Nullifying the swearings and the vows. It goes together. We do it Most people start already to do it Rosh Chodesh Elul, first time. Then Erev Rosh Hashanah, the morning before the Rosh Hashanah evening, which is the judgment day, which comes in 3 weeks. And one on Yom Kippur morning, before Yom Kippur start in the morning. And the last one is in Kol Nidrei. When Yom Kippur start, we're holding the Sifre Torah and everyone crying and hugging the Sefer Torah. What are we singing? Kol Nidrei, it's in Aramaic. All the vows and the swearing and the promises and all that we made will be dismissed and canceled. This why you want to come in front of God and praying and you owe and you promise and you didn't keep. You have a list of problems. You got to clear them out first. So this is nullifying the swearing. But if you owe money, you can nullify the promises you made as much as you want. It won't help you until you give back the money. You owe, you have to pay. Somebody gave you a loan, you're not paying. Oh no, I nullify my promise. Doesn't help. You gotta pay back what you owe. Unless if you had Shnat Shemitah, that's a different story. Shnat Shemitah, every 7 years it dismissed everything. That's why people go to the Beit Din before and make a declaration. It's called Prosbol. Hillel HaZaken made that law that now you don't owe me, you owe the Beit Din. And when you owe the Beit Din, they owe me. You understand what we do? I will be forced to dismiss the loan because Shnat Shemitah is coming. Look at the kind of faith that people are required to have. Someone owe you $1 million. Or he comes to borrow from you $1 million 3 months before the Shnat Shemitah is starting. Every 7 years, you have a year of a strike, Shemitah. Who is going to give him the money? Are you crazy? I'm going to give you three weeks. I'm going to have to reap the shtar. I cannot collect from you. So people didn't want to give loans. But up to certain generation, people actually gave loans shortly before the year starts. Shortly, they have to drop the loan. And they gave to the poor people. Eventually, they started to see, well, whoa, this guy comes to me. Come back to me right after. When the Shnat Shemitah already come, after that you come to me and I'll give you the loan, no problem. Like this, I have 7 years time to collect. Come to me 2 months before, how am I going to collect? So Hillel saw that the rich people stopped giving loans to the poor. Nobody wants to give. The closer you get to the Shnat Shemitah, less and less people giving. We had to make that decree that don't worry, you get it back one way or the other. If not directly, you get it through the Beit Din. That's called the agreement called Prosbol. Same thing, they made Heteriska. When two Jews wants to give a loan one to each other and charge interest, is not permitted. Not permitted to give interest, not permitted to receive interest, not permitted to be a witness in an agreement when two Jews are making an agreement that one will pay interest to the other, not allowed to make a shidduch between two Jews. Hey, Reuven, you need money? My friend Shimon is looking to invest his money and make interest. Come tomorrow to my house, we'll make a meeting. And because of you they did, it's also a violation. So even the person who pays interest gets severe punishment. Nevertheless, the one who receives. So since people knew it's not allowed, nobody wants to deal with Jews. Let me deal with the goyim. The goy, I can charge interest. When I'm going to give money to my friend, help him in his business, I'm not allowed to charge him interest. I'll give Vini and charge him interest. And I take his house as collateral. Vini doesn't pay. I get his house in Bay Ridge. It's mine. You know, it's no problem. Why should I give Yosef? I cannot touch his house. So that's what happens. So the rabbis made a partnership agreement. It's almost the same thing. Same lady with a different dress. You got the point? It's really the same. You give him $100,000 and you receive $2,000. But you defined it in a contract that you are making X amount of percent from the profit of the business. Now, how do you protect your investment? You're right that the first profit that comes in the business up to $2,000 is mine. All the rest above it is yours. This is the way the partnership is. Which means if the business made, I don't know, $3,000, you gave him a loan, you took two and he left with $1,000, which is not even enough for him to to do anything. Why? Because the first 2,000 is mine. Everything else is yours. What happened if there was no profit at all, not even a dollar? That month you lost $2,000. You cannot get it next month. For that month, your partner, the business did not make profit. So how you overcome this problem? If he has other businesses, he opened now a store and he needed a loan for that pizza shop. But he has an auto repair place besides that. So you tell him, you want to get a loan from me? Fine. But I'm a partner in everything you owe. Not only in a pizza shop. I'm not taking a risk if your store will be busy or not. I want to be partner in all your businesses. Your gold business, your auto repair, your real estate, and in a pizza shop. In between four or two or three businesses that you own, the first 2,000 that comes in either one of these businesses, or all of them combined, is mine. So you minimize your chance to lose. But it's a legitimate partnership. What happened if the mafia came and burned all his businesses? And for assume there's no insurance, and he lost all his money, you lost your money. But if it was Vinny, you say, Vinny, I'm very sorry, move out of the house. I have the deed, get out. You didn't pay the money, the principal. Have mercy on me, you know, the mafia burned all my businesses. But your house is now mine. But with the Jew, he cannot do it. Because the house doesn't bring profit. He lives there. It's not a business. It's a big problem. So the only way that people really do give loans today is with the way I described. The Chachamim made this agreement of partnership. Heter, heter means permission. Iska means deal. Deal's permission. Instead of loan, we're making it an official investment. But for many big rabbis I heard, and I'm telling you that it's 100% legit, that even if you do this and you're not violating the rules, because Chazal made this official agreement, there is no blessing in this kind of profits. No blessing. If a person make pure interest without this agreement, just give a loan and charge interest, it's just a matter of time until all his businesses will collapse completely, always. That's one of the most clear punishments that Hashem gives. Sometimes you don't see the punishment. Mechalel Shabbat, age 90, still driving his Rolls Royce in Ocean Parkway on Shabbat. But this kind of businesses, mamash, one by one, I saw it in my own eyes. Psh, everything collapsed. Can be 20 years profit. Ooh, he looks like a millionaire. In the end, two or three people calling him like Madoff. People were making a lot of money with him, giving him more and more and more. He was playing hard to get, paying 12% interest. So it looks like, wow, I put $1 million by him, I make $120,000 not doing anything. Let me put another $2 million. Now you make $360,000. Let me put another. Everything he gave you, you reinvested. And now after 20 years, you have $50 million by him. It was $2 million in the beginning, now it's 50. And what happened in the end? Everything is gone. And you get a heart attack. This is what happened to these people in the end. Why is the Jew, you a Jew? Big problem. You understand? Okay, now, so mitzvah number 228, shelo la'ashok. Remember I described before what oshek is. You're holding something that came to you with permission, but when the time comes to release it, you hold to it very tight. And you're forcing the person with all kinds of deceiving and tricks. No, come next week. Call me next week. Go check if I'm in the kitchen. Some people come and say, he knocks on the door. Hi, is your father home? Today I'm not home. Today I'm not home. Come next week. Maybe I'll be here. I'm not embarrassed anymore. He used to be hiding in a box. He say, son, go say that I'm not home. Today, call you from the bedroom. Today, I'm not home, by the way. Come back next month. No embarrassment anymore. I always said, in the time of the Gemara, when a person came to take a loan, a poor person, you have an obligation to help him. The Torah says, open your hands. Patoach tiftach. But that's because most people were honest people. Don't need to go 2,000 or 3,000 years. Even 20, 30 years ago, most people were very honest. Check was a check. Handshake was a handshake. Diamonds are going from hand to hand based on a promise, nothing else. And things was working. Today, if you don't have 50 different kind of protections, this agreement, pictures, video camera, that, bringing that, taking collateral, making the lawyer, deeds, that, and in the end you lose your money. Somehow it doesn't pay. And there's no way to collect. Something you didn't think about. Why? Most people are crooks. So the certainty, the chazakah is changed. It's a very problematic thing what I'm saying. But it's 100% correct. The Torah say to help the poor. They want a loan mitzvah to help them. Today it's not so simple. Why? Every poor who comes, there's 90% chance he'll steal my money. What mitzvah? I worked 20 years and saved. Now I'm going to give it to him to steal? Before, it was almost for sure he's going to return it. He works, he pays $100 every week, as we agreed. Now, as soon as he gets the money, he doesn't answer your phone call a week later. This is what happened everywhere. So chazakah she'anashim ramayim. A person that is chazakah, that is the crook, has no obligation to help him at all. Not allowed to help him, bechlal. You have your children to help too. It's a very problematic thing. But I'm now talking about the official laws of the Torah. So, one of the ways of the people who like to be oshek, oshek, means to send them back and forth. Come next week, come, not today, call me next week. The Torah says, lo ta'ashok et re'echa, holding his money and not releasing it back. Or koveh schar sachir, don't pay the salary or commission, right? Or something by him arrived to you accidentally and you have an obligation to return and you're not returning. You're holding until he gives up. He surrender, right? Okay, now mitzvah number 229, we have a few minutes left. 229, you should not steal in the face of a person. That's called gezel. Gezel, there's no penalty. When you get caught, you pay what you stole. Why? Because he did it in front of his face. Stealing behind his back, if you get caught, you pay double. But that's stealing. Here we're talking about gezel. In his face. So the Torah says, don't steal when he's not around. Don't steal when he's around. This is what we're talking about. Don't steal when he's around. And mitzvah number 230. Don't delay the salary of your workers. Lo le'acher schar sachir. A person who works for you, and the time came for him to receive this money, right? For instance, we're talking now someone who works for you daily. In Hebrew, it's called kablanut, day by day, $100 per day. And the day arrived, the sunset now, the day is over, right? So the Torah says, if the morning comes from then on, sunrise, every second is a sin. Right? Depend. If the time of paying the salary is during the day, as soon as the day arrived, you have a problem. If the time of paying the salary is at night, depend on the nature of the job or whatever, it's a night work, day work. So basically, once the time came and it succeeded and you don't pay, from that moment on, every second is a sin. There's an interesting question in halakha. Some people like to accept Shabbat early. It starts at 8, and it's 7 o'clock already, except Shabbat. He goes to pray mincha early, Shabbat, he comes home, it's still light. What happened? He went to shul, he prayed mincha, he prayed arvit, he sang lecha, dodi, everything is fine, he come home, the food is on the table. And now he remember, oh, Moshe, my worker, I told him to close the store after I left, and I promised him that on my way to shul, I dropped the money, his salary, and I didn't pay him. Wow, I have 10 minutes before officially Shabbat is starting. Officially. It's 10 to 8 now. For me, it's Shabbat 50 minutes already. Once you accept, you accept. You cannot drive, you cannot do anything. Shabbat for you. But all the people are still driving the car in your neighborhood, coming back, going. They didn't go to the Prey Mincha. They accepted an official time. What do? You must find someone of your neighbors, one of the Jews that still did not accept Shabbat. Give him quickly. Come. Here is the money. Take it. Run to this guy. I'll pay you for your efforts. Run, give it to him before Shabbat starts. One Shabbat officially start, every second is a sin. What happened if everyone in your town except Shabbat at 7? All around, there's nobody now to find. You got to find a goy and pay him for the efforts to go and pay. Even if the salary is only $100 and the goy would ask you $70 for the job to go and do it, you have no choice. You got to pay on time. What happened if you don't have a goy? Big problem. You have to violate Shabbat and go and pay it to him. Why? Because for you, Shabbat is not official yet. It's only the Rabbanan. Really, Shabbat didn't start. You accepted it. But you must from the Torah give him, because every second is few sins. Every second, by tomorrow, can be 5,000 sins already to pay him. Unless, if you can run quickly to his house and apologize and ask him permission, and, oh, I'm so sorry, I know, I promise you, forgive me, please, I'll pay you tomorrow. And you cannot give him interest. Cannot tell him, tomorrow I'll give you extra $20 for the inconvenience. It's a lot of laws. It's not so simple. That's why a person, you know, I know one guy here in real estate. I used to be my roommate 20 years ago. He wasn't religious then. He's not religious today, but he's much more traditional today. But 20 years ago, he had nothing to do with religion. He lived a few years in Germany. He's one of these Ashkenazi yekes, but secular, not the religious one, secular. A person that has very interesting manners between him and to other people, and also naturally very honest. Just came the crisis in real estate. One office after the other collapsed. He is the only one that when everyone collapsed and went bankrupt and lost everything they had, and now they owe millions to the bank, and many of them escaped back to Israel because they lost everything, 20 million, 50 million, whatever they had, buildings, houses, everything left like that, real estate died. He's the only one that business never stopped booming by him. Why? He has something that all of us has to learn from him. Once he say, I'm buying it, that's the price. No matter what, he keeps his word. Once he say to the worker, this is what I'm going to pay you on that date. He sold, he didn't sell, he pays. Very interesting. Once I know a person that he agreed with him that he will sell him a lot here somewhere for X amount of money. After the calculation, the person was selling, he was under pressure to sell the lot. The deal was agreed already. The next morning, he was supposed to give him the money. He called him up the day before. They agree on the price, that's it. He cannot back up. All the papers were signed, everything. He told him, you know, I calculated and I found out that I'm losing a few thousand from my own pocket. Every other person would tell him, what do you want from me? We agree on the price. That's it, I bought it already. So how much you lost? Told him, I think $4,000 or $5,000 more. He say, if I give you $5,000 more, you'll be happy? And I'll make you feel good about the deal? He say, yes. He say, no problem, I'll add it to you. The papers are signed already. Not religious guy. And he paid him back the money. Everyone died in real estate. He's the only one who grows, and the banks are begging him to give him money. 21 years, he started as a salesman. And today he owns one of the biggest offices, and business continue to boom when everyone in America almost have no food to eat. And he's booming. And think about it. All the business in the area went to him, because there's not that much business. Everyone closed. But he continued to buy and expand against all odds. Honesty, integrity, in the long run, is the best thing to do, the best. In the short run, yeah, you progress slowly. And all the sharks, the thieves, it looks like they grow fast. But the higher you get, when you fall, it's much more painful. Falling, oh, it's so painful. Falling from the first floor or from the 50th floor, it's not the same. So here, never delay a salary. Always paid on time. Never play games with people about money. Promise, even the deal turns a very bad deal, hundreds of thousands, he buy in the end. I say, I'm buying, finished. Don't need witnesses, don't need contracts, lawyers. I say, I'm buying. This is it. Mitzvah number 231, not to curse any Jew, male or female, even if he's deaf, can hear. What's the difference? A person who hears, you're insulting him. Hey, you, making up a name, gets very insulted because he heard. But you walk behind a deaf person, you're foolish, you're stupid, and he goes like this in the street and happy. And everyone here, well, look, this guy's cursing him, and he's happy, this one. Why doesn't he hear? He's not suffering. You may think what the Torah says not to curse is people who get offended. Or people who don't hear, what's the big deal? You curse him as much as you want. It's therapy for me. Rabbi, I get all my anger out like this. I have this, my cousin is deaf. Whenever I get angry, I call him, hey, Itzik! Imach shimcha, you should say, Itzik say, no problem. Now I took everything out. Baruch Hashem. Not allowed. Not allowed. So, only someone who is alive, right? The Torah spoke about. But what happens if you curse the person that is dead already? That's a different problem. But the cursing doesn't, it's not applied to someone who is dead already. It's not making any difference. Only two people are still alive. It's a cherem on that cherem. But from the Torah, if you curse someone who died already, if it's a wicked person, something like that, no nicha. If it's a righteous person, you're cursing him, the rabbi says a cherem, which means a ban. The chachamim puts a ban on it. Not the person will not get used to do such a thing. Mitzvah number 232, not to put a trap in front of a person, which means a person walks in the street and you put something and trip him and he falls. That's the classical scenario. But it's not only talking about this, literally. If your friend is not a businessman and he asks you an advice, don't give him a bad advice because your cousin is going to benefit from it. Oh, yeah, yeah, sell. It's good now to sell. You know who's buying. So you're giving him a bad advice. Oh, don't sell now. Why? Because you want to get money that you can go and buy it. But in the meantime, he's going to lose money because the market is going down. You know in a month you're getting money. You say, don't buy to this. Don't sell it to this customer. He's not such a good person. Don't worry. I'll find you a customer. A month later you come. Okay, let me buy it from you. You understand? That's not a fair deal. They're not allowed to do it. Bottom line, putting a trap in front of a blind person is not permitted. But now we're not talking blind literally. That's besides the point. It's also not permitted. Everyone who is blind in this field, in Torah, he doesn't know anything, you take advantage on him. You know, this is the halacha, this is what you do. You should not do because he's serving you. I know one person wasn't an honest person, and he had someone learning by him, and that person was teaching all the new Baalei Tshuva Torah. And he was doing it as a part of his salary as an avrech. He learns in a kollel, he gets a few hundred dollars a month. And while he's there, everyone takes advantage on his good heart and tell him, come, teach this group, come, teach this group. So half of his day was teaching beginners, which technically is not progressing. It's keep going from teaching him to read Gemara, teaching him. It's really like, in a way, it's like waste of time for him. Usually people like this, they get a salary from the yeshiva. But him, since he's already learning in yeshiva, he was taking an advantage on him. After a few years, that guy wanted to move to Israel to grow, to become more, much bigger in Torah. So he went to meet with him. So he told him, I want to go now to this yeshiva in Bnei Brak, in Israel. So he told him, no, you shouldn't go to Israel. It's horrible over there. You know how difficult it is. The yeshivot don't have money. You're going to get stuck with no parnasa. All he cared about is, how am I going to lose such a person who does the job for me for free? I'm taking advantage on him. Don't have to pay him. So when he told me what he told him, quietly I told him, don't listen to him. Quickly, buy tickets quickly. Don't even tell him. You tell him from the airport that you're on the way to Israel. Don't listen to him. He doesn't tell you what's good for you. He tells you what's good for him. Of course it's good for you. The yeshiva you want to go. Baruch Hashem, he took my advice. He's one of the biggest rabbis in Israel today. Speak on the television, speak on the radio. He, from all over Israel, they're asking him questions in halacha. He sat a few years and learned, became a giant. Mamash big chacham. If we would be here in the level, continue to teach people, maybe today he can explain you a little bit about the Taryag Mitzvot. Maybe. That's the difference. This is, we're talking more than 10 years ago. Now he's a very big rabbi. He's a very important rabbi. He already gave us kamot to Sfarim. When people want to write a book, they go to him to confirm. And he writes, became very big. Imagine if we stay here with his advice. That's atzat achitofel. That's called lifnei iver lo titen michshon. Now, this guy was afraid of him. You know, he's telling him stay here, but in the end, of course, what does he have to do here? Well, he's already in a level that he has to move, not to yeshiva of Baalei Tshuva, to yeshiva of top learners. Over there, what you do here in a week, you do over there in a day. After a year, it's a massive change in your life. And exactly, that's what happened. Then, mitzvah number, mamash few more minutes, mitzvah number 233, not to do avel b'mishpat. Not to be not fair in the judgment, in a trial. What is the avel? The Torah says, lo ta'asu avel b'mishpat. What's the right word in English for avel? Avel, when you do something not fair to someone. How do you call it in English? Avel. Avel. Not a fair, not a justice, not against justice. Right? For instance, you are delaying the trial. You're supposed to be a witness, and on purpose you're not showing up, playing tricks, pretending you didn't get the papers, and this person losing rent. The more times, he's losing. Or you're playing all kinds of tricks, and somebody is getting affected from this. That's called lo ta'ase avel b'mishpat. For instance, you know a testimony, and you on purpose go to overseas, that by the time you come back, maybe they give up. And in the meantime, the crook will get away. Why? Because you like this guy. I don't know, he did you a favor. Whatever the case is, all kinds of things like this. It's a very large range of things that it's avel. That's called lo ta'asu avel b'mishpat. Mitzvah number 234, not to respect a greater person in the judgment. If you're the judge, and you have an ordinary person and a very important prime minister, or a very important rich person, or a very big rabbi, what happened to the judges automatically? When the ordinary person wants to speak, wait, don't talk now, we're busy. But if the rich one wants to say, excuse me, judge, I want to say something. Yes, your majesty. Yeah, well. No. On the street, yeah. In front of the judge, you are zero and you are zero. The trial is over. Everyone gets back the respect they deserve. But right now, you talk, he talks the same. I listen to you, I listen to him. I don't automatically take your side. Why? I have to be a fair judge. That's called lo lechabet gadol badin. Not to give extra respect to a person, even that everyone gives him automatically respect, and even you, out of the courtroom, the Torah says, lo te'edar pne gadol. You say, he's a rich guy. His father was the very big rav. How can I not give him respect? His father was a very big rav in our city. Gotta give him respect. He's an important, from important family. Not in a court. On a street, yes, but not in a court. Now, 235, and this is it for today, I think, the last one. 235, an obligation of the judge to judge injustice. Betzedek tishpot amitecha. You have to do fair trial, fair judgment, which means well, some of the things I said before also apply to here. For instance, when one wants to talk 2 minutes, so he says, okay, you can talk 2 minutes, and the other one, no, we got you. You can talk 20 seconds. You don't need to talk 20 minutes. I got the point. Automatically already come with the opinions. This guy, we know who he is. Look how he dressed. Look how this guy is. Okay, listen, you're talking not to the point. You know, sometimes you see it in a secular court, is very common. You come with beautiful tie, and a nice jacket with an important lawyer, the judge is talking to you in a very respectable way. But then this guy looks, ripped jeans, this, you know, one of the brothers like this. Right away, the judge already 90% decided before he opened his eye. Excuse me, Mr. Williams, I don't have time for your nonsense. You take the deal, yes or no? He doesn't know what to say. Right away, finish. Why, this guy's an important guy. Look how he dressed. For sure, he's intelligent, he's a professional, whatever. All this nonsense, not permitted. Everyone is equal, no matter a low life, an important person. This is it. Next week, I'm not here. Remember, please don't make mistake and waste your time. Following Monday, I'll be here, Bezrat Hashem, again. And thank you very much. We'll see you. Kol Tov.